Good evening, everyone, and a very warm welcome to all of you. Hope all of you are doing fine and are safe with your families. Today is our third session of Doctors Speak, and it's definitely going to be a very informative session for all of you. Before we start today's session, I would like you to click on the like button and let me know whether I'm audible, whether you can hear me clearly. Also, I would like you to type in the city name in the comments box and tell me where you're from. We would like you to take maximum use of these sessions and also inform your friends and relatives, as you can gain a lot from these knowledgeable sessions. Do share the same in your network and let maximum people know about it. We've started off with these sessions. Our first session was on mental health, and the second one being on hair and skincare at home. Every week, we'll be bringing you different sessions from different doctors. Hello? So thank you everyone for sending your responses. Let me tell you a little bit about Doctors Speak. Doctors Speak is a new initiative at Future Generali India Life Insurance, where we have a series of sessions with medical experts. We would be inviting expert doctors from the field of specialization every week and provide you with expert advice and address any questions you may have. Today's topic is on a very deadly disease, also known as the silent killer, cancer. We will be covering the signs, symptoms, and treatment for cancer in today's session. In today's times, there are many different kinds of cancers which have erupted, ranging from bone cancer, be it blood cancer, breast cancer, uterus, or even eye cancer. The loneliness and isolation feeling when one is diagnosed with this disease can affect one's mental health, and it can also affect the health of the family member. Some people actually believe that getting cancer is purely genetical or fate of bad luck, but that's not true. It can affect anyone, be it adults or even children. Cancer affects not only the person who is diagnosed with it, but also his friends and family members. But with the advancements in medical sciences, there are many treatments available today and which give us a ray of hope. Also, an early diagnosis, expert help, and treatment could help one to tide over this disease and come back to normalcy. For today's session, we welcome Dr. Darshana Rane, a highly knowledgeable doctor from Nanavati Max Super Speciality Hospital. She has done her DNB General Medicine from KEM Hospital. She has worked as a senior resident at Tata Memorial Hospital in Mumbai, followed by the DNB Medical Oncology at Prince Ali Khan Hospital, where she has trained in stem cell transplantation. She has also done her observership in oncology at King's College in London. A certified medical oncologist from European Society of Medical Oncology, she treats both hematological malignancies as well as solid tumors for adults as well as children. Very interesting to tell you that she also trains nurses in chemotherapy and organizes monthly academic meetings in oncology at various hospitals. Good evening, Dr. Darshana Rane, and welcome to our live session on Doctors Speak.
Hello, good evening. Thank you for that warm welcome and the kind words. Without wasting further time, let us begin with our session. So here we are speaking on the topic of today, cancer, the signs, symptoms, and the treatment.
Sure. So, doctor, I will just give you a heads up on the flow of the event. You can give your presentation. You can talk to people about what you want to speak to them about cancer, post which we will have some questions coming in from our audience, and I will address those to you. Requesting all the people in the audience, do put in your comments, get all your queries answered. We have an expert doctor on our panel, and this should be your best chance to get what you want to know. So over to you, doctor, and thank you very much for giving us your time and coming on this session.
Welcome. Thank you. Can you see my PPT? Excuse me.
See you. We can see the PPT.
Shiraz, can you see my PPT?
Yes, doctor, it's visible.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Yes, thank you.
So here I am to spread some general cancer awareness. Myself, Dr. Darshana Rani. I am a senior consultant in medical oncology and hemato-oncology at Nanavati Max Super Speciality Hospital. And what are we going to discuss? We are going to discuss mainly about cancer, how it develops, what are the types, what is the magnitude of the problem, what is the causes, how to prevent or early detect the cancer, how to diagnose the cancer, and what treatment options we have today. So what is cancer? Cancer is nothing but abnormal, uncontrolled cell growth. And the WHO defines it as a rapid increase of these abnormal cells and which cross their boundaries and can invade the adjacent parts and also spread to the other organs, which is known as metastasis. And this metastasis is a main cause of death from cancer. So here are some terminologies that I would like to introduce you. One is metastasis, which means spread to the other body parts. It can be through the blood vessels or the lymph vessels. And it can also spread by a direct spread. And carcinogens are the substances which cause the cancer. So here is an overview of how actually the cancer spreads. Cancer does not spread overnight. It takes a series of steps wherein the cell is genetically altered first. It grows when we call it as this hyperplasia. Then it mutates and it we call it as dysplasia. Then it grows just at the level of the membrane, which we call it as in situ cancer. And then it starts growing really fast, wherein we call it as invasive cancer. So this is a basic DNA copy, as we see, and this is the mutated DNA copy. So the first step is DNA mutation, and this genetically altered cell, after the first mutation, as you can see here in pink, the remaining being the cream colored. So the pink is the mutated cell. So there's not just one mutation, but there can be growth of the one mutation, as you can see the rapid proliferation of these pink cells. Then can be a second mutation wherein you can see this purple colored abnormal cell. And this, once the second mutation takes its peak, a third mutation may present and a fourth and so on. And there can be many mutations actually in a tumor. Also, the tumor then, when it grows, it tries to break through the wall of the part in which it is present, which we call it as invasion. And then what happens? There are blood vessels which come to feed this particular abnormal growth. And hence, it becomes more and more proliferative, which means it grows more and starts invading other body parts and spreads to the other body parts. So this is the way the tumor really spreads. It can spread to the blood, through the blood flow, to the various organs, and it forms these tumor deposits, which we know as metastasis. So normally, once one notices a lump, it need not be a malignant lump always. It can be a benign tumor, which means it is not really cancerous. And it can be a malignant tumor, which means it is a cancer. And there are various factors which we can compare with to define the benign and malignant. But mainly one must understand that a malignant growth is usually rapidly increasing, and it really tries to spread to the other organs as well. So what is the global burden of cancer? After diabetes, cancer is the second most common cause of global deaths. That is noted in the global NCD data. In the world, 7.6 million of people died from cancer in 2008. And 70% of the cancer deaths occur in the low and middle income countries. and 30% of these could be prevented. So what are the main cancers which can cause to death? The mortality is mainly due to the cancers which are there in the lung, the stomach, the liver, the colon, and the breast cancer. And about 30% of the leading these cancer deaths are due to the five leading factors. One is your high body mass index, that is your weight, the low intake of fruit and vegetable, lack of physical activity, and the addiction, especially tobacco and alcohol. Now, tobacco use is the causes 22% of the global cancer deaths and 70% of global lung cancer deaths. And the other causes are the infections, which are the hepatitis B and hepatitis C, and the human papilloma virus, which causes 20% cancer death in the low and middle income countries. So this is the Globocan data of 2012 from India, and it shows that the breast and the uterine cancers, they are the most common causes of cancers noted in India in both sexes. This is for the female, and for the male, it is most commonly in the lung, the lip, and the oral cavity. And what we note that there are around 6 million new cases of cancer in both male and female. And what is the new scenario in India? In the year 2010, there were 786 number of cancer cases. And in the year 2020, we have around over a million. And this causes, so there are almost 10,000 lakhs of new cancer cases developed every year. So what are the most common causes of cancer? As we know, genetic, lifestyle, environment, and viral causes are the most common causes. Now let us see the what genetic means. So genetic means the DNA mutations, and there are two types of genetic mutations which do occur, but there are three major classes of genes which we know. One are the proto-oncogenes, one are the oncogenes, and then one are the tumor suppressor genes. And so it may sound a bit complicated, but to tell you in brief, that oncogenes are the one which promote cell growth, and tumor suppressor genes are something which stops the cell growth. And the oncogenes, they act as a gas pedal, which means it increases the cancer spread, and the tumor suppressor are the basically brakes. Secondly, the lifestyle factors. Inactivity, obesity, dietary intake of fatty diet, low in vegetables and fruits, they are the major causes of breast and colon cancer. High calorie intake food and also cause breast cancer risk, and also endometrial and gallbladder cancers. Alcohol causes oral cancers, the cancers are of the throat and the voice box, the food pipe, and the liver. Tobacco causes a variety of diseases, not just cancer, but the cigarette chewing of tobacco, and other tobacco products like the pan masalas, they cause risk to mouth and the laryngeal cancer. Also, esophageal and lung cancer are also caused by tobacco. Now, tobacco is not just the mere intake of the tobacco, but also those who are around the people smoking, the passive smokers, they are also the ones which get affected because of this secondhand smoke to lead them to cause a cancer. So environmental factors, the ingested chemicals that we see in all the food products, especially the ones which are used for the storage, and the environment and the industrial pollutants like asbestos, nickel, cadmium, uranium, radon, vinyl chloride, benzidine, benzene. Then radiations, microorganisms, ionizing radiations like X-rays, UV rays, and other the high rays which are used in CT scans. These are also, if given in a very unproportional use, in dose, can cause cancers over the long term. Now, viruses, here are a list of common viruses giving rise to cancer. We have the Epstein-Barr virus, which can cause Burkitt's lymphoma. Human papilloma virus can cause cervical cancer, that's a uterine cancer. Hepatitis B virus, which may cause liver cancer. We have a human T-cell lymphotropic virus, which can cause leukemia. And the Kaposi sarcoma-associated herpes virus, which will cause Kaposi's sarcoma. And there are more other risk factors like age, then excess of estrogen, which does happen because of obesity again. Then family history, the family's heredity or the family's environment and lifestyle tendencies also can cause cancer. So how do we prevent this cancer? So you have to avoid the major culprits. So in India, we have noted that tobacco is a leading cause. So avoid tobacco in all its forms. Also, one needs to take care of those who smoke, and they need to really understand that not just themselves, but they are also risking those around them, their loved ones, with their smoke, to prone them to developing the cancer. Controlling the diet and weight. So the aim is to eat correct. You can have your non-vegetarian diet, you can have your fatty diet, but definitely take a regular healthy vegetable and a fruit intake. Also, water intake is important. The fiber intake is important. Exercise regularly. Protect the skin from sun. Avoid the environmental and occupational carcinogens. And being aware of the warning signs. So you once notice something, one should not sit on it and take the necessary step and the necessary recommended screening test to find out whether one is having the disease or not. So what are the cancer symptoms that one sees? So there can be a lump or a thickening in the breast or any other part of the body which one can note. There can be any change in the shape or color of a wart or a mole, a sore that does not heal, which leaving behind an ulcer, which not necessarily needs to be painful, a nagging cough or a hoarseness, change in the bowel habits or bladder habits, difficulty in swallowing or indigestion, unexplained weight loss without any reason, unusual bleeding or discharge from any part of the body. So these are the common symptoms. And so prevention and early detection of cancer has become very important, because prevention is something which will lead to a better outcome. Now, cancer is definitely preventable. 30% we know do our habits and activities, and cancer can involve every body part. So we must note that we have to take care of ourselves first. So 70 to 80% of the cancers are detected in late stages because of the fact that most of these symptoms are similar to those which happen because of multiple other reasons, and hence we tend to ignore them. So early detection helps in complete cure of many cancers, and prevention can be taken as a precautionary measure. So cigarette smoking, which is a major cause, as again I told you, it can be active or passive, both are harmful. And khaini, zarda, gutka, all the other forms of tobacco are harmful. And not just cancer, but tobacco is also the cause of hypertension, that's the blood pressure, and other heart diseases, the stroke, and infertility in ladies. And tobacco is one agent which does not cause only the oral cancer, but it can cause cancer of around 8 different organs of the body. So it is very important that we quit tobacco now. So betel nut is the one which is the important culprit. And in certain parts of the country, especially the northeast, these betel nuts are buried in the ground, and which make them to ferment, and then that makes them more carcinogenic. And people consuming betel nut have this habit of consuming tobacco as well. So alcohol is another one which can cause multiple sites of cancer. So it can cause oral, the throat pipe, the food pipe, the stomach, liver, and also generally those who consume alcohol, they tend to smoke. So the risk of cancer development increases. So if you can take high intake of the animal fat, that increases the risk of developing breast and colon, as we discussed, and dietary fiber hence to protect against this. Also, very commonly consumed barbecued food, the charcoal is the one which causes carcinogenic effect. So more black the thing, it's more dangerous. Another important thing that we are facing today is air pollution. And the marble factory workers are the ones which tend to be exposed to this kind of pollution, which can be carcinogenic. So water also, one must make sure that, you know, one takes good potable water, because there are a lot of industrial waste which is being dumped into the water, and hence it can also lead to consumption of those carcinogens. So one also, X-ray should not be done in pregnant women for the same reasons. So there are these viruses which can cause, like hepatitis B, C, Epstein-Barr, HPV, CMV, etc. These basically viruses are transmitted by blood transfusion or by contaminated needles from mother to child during pregnancy, breastfeeding, or through sexual contact. So one must remember to take adequate precautions. Also, one has noted that in the treatment of hepatitis B and C, the people who take the treatment for these, they tend to develop less cancer. So one must take the hepatitis vaccines. One must take the hepatitis treatment. Also, human papilloma virus vaccines are available now for young children from age 19 to 13. From age 9 to 13, to prevent them from catching the human papilloma virus when they grow up. So those are some things that we can do from our end. However, there are certain cancers which are not really in our control, and they are spread through the hereditary, like retinoblastoma and certain breast and esophageal cancers as well. So also the colon cancers, some of them have tendency for hereditary transmission. Now, how can we really prevent this disease? How can we early detect these cancers? This should be the main intention now. So why are the early detection important? Because it gives better results on the treatment and can also cure most of the disease. And as the disease advances, the result of the treatment becomes poor, and then there is a burden on the finances and also a psychological trauma that one faces once the disease is in the advanced stage. So how to detect these diseases early? So there are, as we discussed, there are these danger signals that one should be aware of, like the change in the bladder, bowel habits, ulcer in the throat, or some bleeding or discharge, or lump in the body or breast or anywhere, in some difficulty in swallowing, a change in the wart or mole, nagging cough or hoarseness. And there are other site-specific symptoms which we have been noticing. One is the laryngeal cancer, which can cause hoarseness or ulcer in the neck, a lump in the neck. Then they can also notice difficulty in swallowing. And alcohol and tobacco are the known risk factors. Persistent white or red patches, usually painless, and any persistent lump or a swelling in the oral cavity are the warning signals of oral cancer. Again, tobacco and alcohol are the risk factors which lead to this. Lung cancer, chronic or the prolonged cough, which coughing out of blood, any change in the voice, chest pain, shortness of breath on walking only a short distance, or even while sitting or while speaking or while doing any day-to-day activities. Again, risk factors include smoking, the asbestos, coal tar derivatives, which are there in the industrial factories, radiation exposure. Breast cancer, what are the warning symptoms? Any lump or any changes in the nipple, discharge from the nipple, or redness of the breast, which we call as inflammatory changes. Those are the, or any lump which you note in the axilla, those are the factors one must be aware of. And what are the risk factors? Early menstruation, late menopause, first child after 35, not having a child, family history of breast cancer, and a high fat and low fiber diet. Cervical cancer, that's the lower part of the uterine cavity, can cause abnormal bleeding, that is bleeding in between the periods, or after the patient has stopped the periods, that's after menopause, after sexual intercourse, during menstruation. If the patient has got prolonged heavy bleeding, then one must visit a gynecologist for further evaluation. Multiple sexual partners and having multiple children are also the risk factors for cervical cancer. The colorectal cancer warning symptoms are blood in stool, feeling of being bloated, change in the bowel habits. Sometimes there will be constipation, sometimes there will be loose motions, but loose motions without really passing any motions, just passing water. Those are the risk factors. And age above 40, family history with a colon cancer or any inflammatory bowel disease, or family history of any polyps in the colon, past history of any breast cancer or any uterine cancer in case of female, can cause a secondary colorectal cancer as well. Consumption of red meat and low fiber diet. Then we go to esophageal cancer. Esophagus is nothing but the food pipe, and one, as the location says, experience difficulty in swallowing and recurrent indigestion. And risk factors are smoking, alcohol, and a deficiency of the vitamins and minerals. Screening, how can we check for the cancer or for the conditions that may lead to cancer in a person who does not have the symptoms of the disease? So one, after certain age, like in females, after age 40, one must do yearly mammography for the breast and pap smear for the cervical cancer. And the clinical and signs and symptoms are tested. A physical examination has been is done of the entire body, and certain imaging tests are advised by the doctor in the screening test. So how do we do other tests for diagnosing the cancer? So we have certain tests which we do based on the site of the cancer and based on the symptoms what the patient notes. So certain those patients who have got some GI, the gastrointestinal issues, we usually advise them to do stool tests to see whether any hidden blood which is seen, which shows the possibility of the colon cancer. Urine test can also be done. A complete blood count to see whether any hematological malignancies like leukemia and myeloma. Also, there are histological examinations which are done of not just the biopsy material, but also we do the further evaluation of the fluid, like the fluid which happens in the lung, the fluid which happens in the abdomen in certain diseases can also be tested and evaluated for the presence of cancer. There are certain blood parameters which we call it as tumor markers. Like we have prostate specific antigen, which tells us the presence of prostate cancer, and CA19.9, which tells us about pancreatic cancer, CA125, which tells us about the ovarian cancer. So microscopic appearances of cancer cells and the normal cells are also tested by the laboratory on these biopsy material or these fluid material. And the cancer is staged by the various imaging modalities that we have, the CT scan, the MRI, the PET CT. And based on where they are spread, one has stage 0 to stage 4, wherein stage 4 is the metastatic stage, wherein the cancer has already spread to the distant parts of the body and hence have become inoperable now. Though not all stage 4 cancers are inoperable, we do operate certain stage 4 cancers as well. So there is a difference between the stage and the grade of cancer. Sometimes patients try to read the reports, Google it out and find out then they have a high grade cancer and then they get worried. So stage is a different thing and a grade is a different thing. Grade tells us basically where the tumor, how the tumor is on the microscope and how the tumor may, so it's a high grade tumor, it grows faster. That is the meaning of grade. And stage means where the tumor has spread in the body. So what treatment options do we have today? So we have surgery, radiation therapy, chemotherapy, hormonal therapy, biological therapy, which includes not just targeted therapies, but we also have immunotherapies. And surgery is to prevent cancer, to diagnose cancer, to stage cancer, to cure cancer. So the surgery can be used to do all such things in a cancer. And the surgery can also, as we say, even in stage 4 cancer, we do surgery to reduce the bulk of the tumor, or it can be due to give, it can be done to give some quality to the life, which we call it as palliative. It can also be to restore the person's appearance or function of the body part which is removed after the primary surgery, in which we call it as reconstructive surgery. So radiation therapy uses are there for certain tumors, and it's a very targeted type of a therapy which we give by the use of high energy radiation, and it causes killing of cancer cells, and approximately 50 to 60% of the cancers are treated this way. And basically the goals are, it's usually not given alone. But in certain cancers, we can use it alone. It can also be given before a surgery or after, to shrink the disease size. It can be given during the surgery as a therapeutic modality to kill the tumor. It can be also given after the surgery to kill the remaining cells which are left over after the tumor has been removed. It can be given also with the chemotherapy to cause further reduction of the tumor burden. Another important part of radiation is to relieve pain when the tumor spreads to the other parts of the body and it causes pain because of being in that part of the body. The radiation therapy helps to relieve the pain of that part. And there can be an external beam radiation wherein it's given from above. You can be given by placing some rods into the body, which is known as brachytherapy for selected organs. And we have this important thing known as a chemotherapy, which we use for most of our cancers, and it helps to prevent the cells from multiplying and metastasizing, and it helps basically to prevent the rapid rate of the turnover of the disease. And it is given with the intention of not just curing, but also to control the disease so that the patient has a better quality of life with minimal toxicity. So there are many agents which are there, which can help to prevent the cancer. There are many ways how to detect the cancer early. And as we understand, the prevention is definitely better than cure. And hence, I urge you to join me with this fight against the cancer. So thank you for the patient hearing.
Thank you, Doctor. That was indeed very insightful. A lot of learning from your session. I mean, I learned a lot on what you said, that, you know, even barbecued food and excess of charcoal in your food, etc., can lead to cancer. Also, the different viruses which are there can affect you with cancer. So thank you. It was very, very insightful. Thank you for the session. We do have some questions coming in from the audience, and I can just take them on right now. There's a question from Shaz. He wants to know which food items can be consumed to avoid the risk of cancer.
So, many people come to us and they ask us that what is the diet that we need to consume and all that. So basically, one must stick to the basics. We have to consume a well-balanced diet, which has good amounts of protein, good amount of fiber, good amount of all the other nutrition, the minerals and the vitamins which are there. Lot of body, lot of agents like the processed food, the packed food, they contain lot of preservatives which are really harmful. So one must learn to avoid all of that. Consume vegetables raw, if at all possible, salads, fruits without juicing them. You can avoid making soups and purees. You know, try to consume it as a whole. That will include, that will give a lot of fiber. That should help in preventing the obesity and the other risk factors, the hyperestrogen levels and all that.
Thank you, Doctor. Next question we have is from Abhinav. His question is, why is cancer so lethal and why are the survival chances so minimal?
So cancer, not all cancers are lethal. And we saw that cancer has to be detected early to have the best chances. So one must try to first prevent, then try to detect it early. Any warning symptoms should not be taken lightly. Try to at least evaluate by your general physician as to what it is. And, if there are certain tests that he has advised, try to do them. Not to neglect any the problem which are nagging. And try to follow the advice given by your cancer specialist is one other important thing.
That's great, Doctor. We have the next question from Tejal. Her question is, which cancers have a high chance of recurrence?
So there are many cancers which have a high chance of recurrence. Most commonly, we have these oral cavity cancers, which the cancers which are caused mainly because of the tobacco and the alcohol consumption. Those tend to recur quite often. Another most recurring cancers are the ones in the brain. So those are the two most common cancers which tend to recur. Other cancers which are seen to recur are breast cancers, but not all breast cancers. There are certain subtype of a breast cancer which tries to recur fast, which is a triple negative breast cancer. So these are the cancers which, and the lung cancer, which we see that they recur more often.
Okay, doctor, there is a question which is from Lakshmi. She says her brother, who is around 69 years of age and has been having fever for a couple of months, around 3 months. It's mild, his fever, it's between 99 to say 100.5. And the doctor has advised him to take a couple of tests, which are MP, MRI, prostate, ER plus VM1 after prostatic massage. And the reports which are given are 9.35, which is his PCA, and the urea shown is high. So what do you think about this, doctor?
So I think she needs to see me personally, because this is a vague kind of a reporting. So I'll be happy to take her directly.
Sure. Next question we have is from Ahira. Can women genetically test the fetus during pregnancy to know if it contains any cancer genes? And if it's possible, where in India is this facility available?
So there are certain tests which one can do if they have a tendency, or if they have this hereditary history in the family. One does not need to do it on the fetus, but do it for themselves first. And another, which are there in various labs, there is cytogenetic testing. And about the fetus per se, so Down syndrome is known to cause a lot of malignancies. So one must try to rule out that first. As such, for the fetus, there are these anomaly scans and all which are done at around 19 to 20 weeks of gestation, which shows what anomalies are there. Accordingly, one does guide them to evaluate further.
Okay, thank you, doctor, for your answer. We have few questions coming in. We have Mehboo B. She wants to know that some cancers may be linked to genetics. And are there any genes that are specific to any cancers, particularly in India?
There are these specific cancer genes which are there, which causes certain cancers, like the BRCA1 and BRCA2, which causes the ovarian cancer, the breast cancer, which is very commonly seen in India. And there are these another genetically the genes which causes colon cancer. So we have various mutations which are seen, which are tested both on the blood as well as the tissue sample to detect the mutations. So yes, there are these commonly seen mutations in India.
Okay, thank you, doctor. We have a common question. They want to know, what are the factors that play a role in the success of a cancer treatment?
Okay, so firstly, one must not get demoralized. One must understand that cancer in today's time is not a deadly disease. Once it is detected, once we need to understand, we should try to report to a doctor at the earliest. Once the reporting is done and the diagnosis is done, the staging is done, a chemotherapy schedule has been prescribed, or any surgery or whatever treatment has been prescribed, to follow it religiously, to eat well, to sleep well, to remain positive at all times. Do not listen to all the forwarded messages on the WhatsApp. Do not Google surf too much. You can always Google, but always discuss it with your physician or your surgeon as to what the validity of whatever you have Googled. So these are very important factors, and there are also cancer support groups. So these groups are basically, they really help patients to connect with each other. They can share their troubles. They each one gives the other some hope in managing the disease.
Doctor, we have a question from Shraddha. She wants to know if somebody is undergoing a treatment for cancer, how do you know if the treatment is actually working?
From time to time, doctor, when prescribes you or treat chemotherapy treatment or any other treatment, they will definitely ask you to follow up with them with certain tests. And a close follow-up is very important. And a regular compliant follow-up is also very important, so that one understands that the cancer treatment is really working or not working.
We have some common questions coming in. What are the actual side effects of chemotherapy?
Yeah, so previously the common side effects would be nausea, vomiting, but now what we have noticed with the newer agents, these kind of side effects are less. Now we are having less of nausea, vomiting, but yeah, there is a distaste or dislike of certain food items one experiences for certain duration. Also, one needs to make sure that they do the proper hygiene care, that we usually advise them to take a lot of oral care, the hand hygiene, the food that they should consume, that should be really fresh, and you know, it should be prepared in a very hygienic way. So that is something which is very important.
Doctor, I have a question from my end. What are the treatment options which are available in India to someone who has cancer? And, you know, apart from like Tata Hospital, who gives you subsidized rates, which are the other hospitals available for people who are diagnosed with this disease and, you know, who can avail of these facilities?
So, yeah, so cancer treatment, definitely we do have a lot of advances. But we also, like cancer treatment is expensive is not always true. A lot of generics are available now in the market, which gives the same drug, but obviously the generic version, at a very, very subsidized and very affordable rates. Also, apart from Tata, most of the corporate hospitals, at least Nanavati does have, and I'm sure most of the corporate hospitals have a medical social worker attached who does try to help the needy people and try to get financial aid from various organizations for the ones who really require.
Next question we have is from Anirudh. If we were to ask you for any lifestyle modifications that we could make today that would lower the risk of anyone contracting cancer, what would it be?
Number one, tobacco. Avoid all forms of tobacco. I get really very disappointed seeing women, you know, smoking, because it's just not lead to the cancer, but also something which one today sees is infertility. So that is something that women should really work on. And second thing is, apart from smoking, one should try to eat well, avoid the fast food, try to consume the freshest, and we don't need to have some exotic fruits. We need to have the local produce, which is easily available. Even your apple and banana and chikku and all these local produce are really good enough. No need to have kiwis and dragon fruits, which is very important to understand. Exercise regularly. These are the important things that one must change in their lifestyle, and also a positive mindset, not to be angry and grumpy and all those things, because that does affect your BMI and your estrogen levels.
Doctor, I had one question. During your presentation, you spoke about that a woman who has a baby after the age of 35 is more susceptible to cancer? What is the reason for that?
So basically, so it's not that woman who has, so basically what happens is, as a woman ages, the level of estrogen also tends to increase. So from the time that she starts getting the periods is the time the ovaries are active and start producing estrogen. Now what happens is when the lady conceives, they produce this hormone called as progesterone. So progesterone is a good hormone which tends to decrease the level of estrogen, and the presence of a very high levels of estrogen in the body and a prolonged high level of estrogen in the body is known to cause risk to developing the breast and the ovarian cancer. And having a baby which ensures that there is a break in the high levels of estrogen and there is some progesterone happening, so it's a good factor. So that causes a decrease in the tendency to cause these cancers.
Okay. Next question is from Abhishek. His question is, we know that some cancers might be linked to genetics. And if so, can we get ourselves tested for these genes to know if we carry them? And where is it that you can get these tests done?
So, yes. So, first, one must understand is anyone cannot just go and test himself for these genetic tests. There is no such requirement. One must have a known relative, first degree relative with the disease. First, that relative needs to be evaluated for whether that person has the risk of transmission to his next generation or no. And then, accordingly, one must take care of all the investigations. But, if one is still wanting that, no, I need to get myself investigated, whatever happens, then there are these tests which are available very easily at most of the common labs. It's done through blood, and but the reports take around 3 to 4 weeks. We can find out the genetic makeup, and accordingly, by the genetic makeup, one can see whether that person can have a tendency to develop cancer or no. So not necessarily that they have a bad genetic makeup means that they will definitely have. It is just that the tendency to develop the cancer remains.
Okay, guys. Thank you, doctor. I just had one question for you. And, as a doctor, you touch so many lives. You are meeting so many people every day. Do you have any story to share about your patients and their lives? I understand that the information can be confidential, but is there any story you would like to share which has really, which is really at the top of your mind and it's not, you cannot forget it?
So more on top of the mind, I would like, so there are a lot of patients who have come to us, and so each has a different story to tell, but a few cases I would like to tell you. A lot of blood cancers which are seen even in the elderly age group, people feel that, the cure rate is zero. And that is not true. And without a transplant, and with the treatment at the right time, with a lot of supportive care, there are a lot of cases. I mean, there is one such patient from Kerala that I have, even who is extremely healthy even today, and he has severe diabetes, and yet he never fails to message me every time. He was diagnosed with acute myeloid leukemia, and we had treated him with the chemotherapy, and now he's completely cured. And this is even without a transplant, so I'm extremely happy with the outcome. And there are quite a many patients, the elderly patients whom we treat with low dose therapy, and they continue to live beyond the time that they have been told by many physicians. So really, nowadays therapies are such that we do see good outcomes, and one must not give up hope. It is very important. One must try to, obviously, there are financial issues. So whatever the constraint, within the constraint, whatever best possible solution that one can find, they should really definitely try to take the therapy. And not worry about the hair loss and all, because that hair loss is a very temporary thing in a cancer. It is just for the time that the therapy is on. Beyond the therapy, the patient does get the hair back. We also have a lot of devices which, you know, put on the scalp while the chemotherapy is injected. And that does cause decrease in the hair loss, though that doesn't really cause 100%, but definitely decreases the incidence of hair loss. And one does note that, you know, the hair growth really comes back to, you know, thick and normal, more than normal rather, after the cancer therapy is done.
That's great to hear, doctor. Last question I would have, is there any memorable case you have, like, you know, the one which you just shared, which gives you a ray of hope? It gives a ray of hope to a patient who's suffering from cancer, or to somebody in his family or friend who's taking care of that patient. Is there anything you would like to talk about?
Yes. So there was this lady who had come to me after taking multiple lines of therapy, and literally she did not want to go any further. And that time there was one targeted agent which was available, you know, at a very exorbitantly high amount. Somehow we managed to get it for her through a lot of funds. Then there was a support program in which she was enrolled, and after a few doses it was given free for her, and she is now taking the treatment for 5 years. So from the point of having no hope to now, she is a grandmother and enjoying her life to her fullest. So that is something that is very important, and it's definitely a ray of hope in the form of a different experience what that lady has enjoyed, from not just being disease free, but, you know, to live her life to the fullest.
That's amazing, doctor. It gives us a lot of positive vibes to hear something like this. I thank you very much for your valuable time. I guess this brings us to the end of the session. We don't have any more questions, and I guess you've answered all the questions very well, and it's been a very informative session. Thank you for coming on to our show, and look forward to meeting you again.
Thank you.
Hope the session has been of good help to everyone, and trust we've been able to address all your queries. Just by making few changes in our lifestyle, such as following a healthy diet, healthy habits, exercise, or any physical activity, and making them a part of our daily routine, these things will go to a long way in keeping us in good health. After all, our health is our biggest wealth. With that note, goodbye, everyone, and thank you for joining us for this session. Thank you.